Welcome, friends. We were talking about relationships, that is the association amongst the records in a table, in among the two tables, two or more tables, right? So, relationships are the power which gives the relational database management systems their success share. Because of these associations, we can run queries, we can execute commands on the database which will fetch data from multiple tables, from multiple logical structures where the data has been stored. So, we were talking that there are different types of relationships. For example, one-to-one relationship. Now, what we are seeing here is that you have two tables, table 1 A and table B, and each table has got number of records. So, in one-to-one relationship, one record from the first table will be related to only one record in the second table. Now, this can be explained by an example, like you have a bank branch and a manager. So, the manager heads exactly one branch, and each branch will have only one person as the manager. So, this type of relationship is known as a one-to-one relationship. Then, if we look at one-to-many relationship, here we see that this is a parent-child kind of relationship. Parent-child relationship infers that one record in table A can be related to more than one record in table B. So, here we can see that, for instance, teacher and course offered. So, one teacher can offer n number of courses, but each course is taught by exactly one teacher. So, this type of relationship is known as parent-child also, because one person can be the parent of multiple children, but each child has exactly one father or only one mother. So, generally we say that one-to-many relationships are parent-child relationship. So, each record will occur once in table A, but the same record can come multiple times in the related table or associated table, that is table B. So, here we can see there is another type of relationship which is known as many-to-many relationship. In many-to-many relationship, we can see multiple records from one table are related to more than one record in the other table. So, you can see here that relationships are there in among multiple tables at the same time. So, if you want to create relationships in Access. So, practically how we do that? So, one thing is important, that when we are trying to create a relationship between the primary key and the foreign key, the relationship has to be a one-to-many relationship. Now, how do you do that? You go to database tools, and from there we choose relationships. When you open the relationships, you can add the tables that you want to build the association between. So, you add the 2, 3, how many tables are there, you add those tables to your window, the tables get added. Now, you can see here that the tables are added. Now, you simply choose the primary key attribute of the primary table, and you lift it with the mouse and drag it, drop it over the foreign key. So, basically you just have to use the mouse's GUI to select the primary key and drop it over the foreign key. So, foreign key is the related attribute in the other table. So, as soon as you will release the mouse, you will see automatically a dialog box will come. In the dialog box, you can see it is showing the primary key and the primary attribute, the related table and the foreign key, and in relationship type you will see one to many is shown. And then you can see three check boxes are there. First says enforce referential integrity, the other says cascade update related fields, and the third says cascade delete related records. So, you have to check all these three. Now, what is the significance of these three? First is, you are enforcing referential integrity means that your foreign key will have only those values which are in the primary key. So, this is referential integrity. In cascade update, what will happen, that if you update or if you change any of the value in the primary key, then the related values in the foreign key columns will be automatically updated. And delete related record means that if you delete a value, if the one record in the primary key table has been deleted, then all the related records in the foreign key table must be deleted first. Otherwise, the DBMS will not allow you to delete a record from the primary table. It will give you a message that related records exist in the other table. So, you first need to either delete those records or you need to make changes to those records. So, for example, if we say professor and department, so department code is the primary key, and in professor table department code becomes the foreign key because you are referring to which department the teacher teaches. Now, for instance, if any one of the department is going to close, then all the teachers which were teaching that department have to be transferred to some other department. So, before you delete the record of the department, you must go and change the department code value of the professor table for all the records. Otherwise, the change will not be shown. It will not be done. So, after you have enforced this and you say create relationship, you can see that a line from the primary key to the foreign key is drawn and you see one and infinity sign is there. So, one and infinity means that this is a one to many relationship. One to many relationship means that in the primary key table, the department code will come only once. But in the professor table, the department code can come n number of times because any number of teachers can be part of the same department. So, therefore, this relationship is known as one to many relationship. If you are creating a relationship between primary key and foreign key, you must know that the relationship type has to be one to many. If you are seeing that the relationship is showing as one to one, it means that you are relating the primary keys of two tables. So, each record is coming only once. So, that is not the requisite thing. We need a one to many relationship when one table's primary key is related to the foreign key in the other table. So, basically when you see that when you are trying to cascade updates, so making a change in a field that is common to two related tables will cause the update to be made in both the tables, and if you delete a field that is common to two tables, the deletion will take place in both the tables. That is, you need to work on the two tables simultaneously because you have created an association or a linkage between these two tables. So, basically, when we are enforcing access referential integrity, we also try on different examples can be tried on how referential integrity can be exercised and how DBMS will help or will prevent the database getting into an unintegrated state because of this kind of a lab. So, it is very important that any database, any tables which are created, the associations between them are correctly done, carefully done, and referential integrity has been enforced. Now, we had also talked about, when we talk about the idea of keys, we talk about the idea of dependency. That is, one attribute is dependent on the other attribute. So, a key helps define entity relationships. So, the key's role is based on a concept known as determination. So, basically determination is also used in the idea of functional dependency. So, these are all related terms. When we talk about dependency, we talk about functional dependency between the tables. So, determination means that A determines B, that is, the value of one attribute will determine the value of the other attribute, and conversely we can say that the attribute B is functionally dependent on the attribute A if A determines B, right. So, if we say that attribute B is functionally dependent on attribute A if A determines B, and if an attribute is a part of a key, then it is known as a key attribute. Why we are saying part of a key? Because we are also keeping in mind the idea or the probability of having a composite key, a primary key which is made up of more than one attribute. So, a multi-attribute key is known as a composite key. Multi-attribute means a key which is made up of more than one attribute is known as a primary key. So we say that when do we say when we have a composite key, that is the primary key is made up of two or more than two attributes. So we say that if the attribute B is functionally dependent on a composite key A, but not on the subset of that composite key, the attribute B is said to be fully functionally dependent on A. Now, what do we mean by this? What we are trying to say that if your primary key is a composite key, then in order to determine the values of the non-key attributes, you need to specify the value of the entire composite key, not just a part of it. Subset means not just a part of it. So, if you want to know the value of the borrower ID, then you need to know the values for the accession number and the date of issue. So, only when you give these two values, you can determine the value of the borrower ID. So, if this is satisfied, then we say that attribute B or the non-key attribute is fully functionally. Fully functionally means in whole, as a total, fully functionally dependent on attribute A. So, we can see here that this is a simple relational database, and the view that you are seeing here, this view of the table is known as the data sheet view. So, in this you can see columns are shown and rows are shown. So, these columns, they are the attributes, and you can also see that there is a line between the vendor code of the vendor table and the product code and the product table, because the vendor code in the vendor table is the primary key which has been used in the product table where it is working as a foreign key. And the values, if you will see, so the foreign key that is in the product table vendor code values will be taken from the vendor code values in the vendor table, not from otherwise. So, now I think we should we can start with queries. Now, queries are very important objects within the databases. So, queries, these are you know, these are very flexible ways, and you can use queries for multiple things. Like you can use queries for viewing data which is stored in tables, most easiest and the most accessible way of looking at the data, then manipulating the data to make new tables. If you have a table in which you have some data, you can make changes to that data, you can update that data. Also, you can add more data to the table. So, append data from one table onto the other. You can insert data into the tables. So, in a relational database, we can have data, we can have forms, we can have tables, and we have queries. So, so far we've been talking about the different aspects of tables and how two tables can be interrelated to each other. Now, the next part that we'll be talking about will be how we can use queries as a tool to view and analyze data into the relational databases. So, queries, why are queries so powerful and why are they so popular in accessing the databases? In fact, the power of the databases lies in the support of the query languages which they have, right? Because it allows the users to have a quick look at the data. It saves once to use regularly. You can save the query and then you can run that query over again. Then you can use these queries to edit or clean your data, right? You can use the query to find out any kind of anomalies or any kind of inconsistencies in the data. Like you can find out the null value. So, it basically null value is an undesirable feature in the database. So, if you want to find out and you want to clean those nulls, so then that can be done. And it assigns easy codes to it, and complex data can be easily viewed. So, you can see the data from multiple tables as a whole using a structured query language tools, right? So, basically we'll be talking about different types of queries. The most common and the most popular query which is used is the SELECT query. So, SELECT query is basically a data retrieval query which helps the user and the database designer to retrieve the data from the databases from the table. So, you can have data retrieval from one table, or you can have data retrieval from more than one table through the same command. Then of course, data construction or table construction or creation can be done, views can be created, multiple logical structures can be created using the commands. Then we have append queries to insert records into the tables which have been created. Then deletion of records is possible through simple statements, and updation of records or updation of data within the records can also be done. So, queries give you a lot of flexible interface to interact and play around with the data in the databases, also keeping the data secure. Because whenever you are working on the query part, then the data in the table remains intact. You are only working on a view of that table, unless you are doing a append, delete or update. So, basically data retrieval queries will only fetch the data, and the result of these queries is also going to be another logical structure, which is going to be a table or a relation only. So, basically you can save those for future use, or you can run those queries whenever the same type of question or the same type of inquiry on the database is being occurring. So, what a select query does, basically it allows you to select data to view. We can pick a table to view, we can choose which fields within the table to see, that is which columns you want to see. You also can sort the records by one or more fields, how many how you want to view your result of the query. Limit which records you want to see, that is if you want to apply filters, those filters can be easily applied. And you can combine data, as I just told you, you can combine data from more than one table using the queries. So, to make a one table query, it's simple. You can choose the select the query object menu. So, you have the create menu in Microsoft Access. From there you can create the query, and you can do it using two ways. Basically, you can do it using the design view of the query, or you can do it using the SQL view or the query, the statement or the command view. So, basically today we are going to only look at the design view and how you can design queries using the design view of the Microsoft Access. So, basically in the design view, it's very simple. You just have to drag and drop the fields, and then you can just run the query, or you can toggle to the data sheet view to see the results. Data sheet view is the sheet view where you see the data. In the design view, you see the way the query is going to be structured, or the command is going to be structured. So, if you see here, we go to the create menu, and in the create menu you can see the query design is there. In query design, you can see here when you choose query design, you see the show table command dialog box is showing. So, in this you can choose one table, or if you want data to come from two or three interrelated tables, the associated tables which are been related, you can add all those tables using the add button. So, you just select the table and the table gets added onto the window. Once the table is added, then you can add more features to it. So, we will just see. So, we have just added one simple table, that is the department table, right. Now, in this case, after this you just have to drag and drop the fields down in the lower panel. So, you can see the field name is shown. So, you just simply drag the field. If you want all the fields, then you can just choose the star above there. So, with star you mean all the fields will be shown into your result. So, now then after that you choose the specific field, automatically the name of the table will be shown if it is only one table. Otherwise, if you have more tables, then also you can see once you drag and drop the field, the name of the table will appear. Then you can also choose whether you want to sort it or not. Then you can also choose whether you want this to be shown or not, because when you are choosing star, you are using the criteria to filter, but sometimes you don't want that particular field to be shown in the result. So, in that case you can uncheck the show box. So, that field will not be appearing in your result, And finally, in the criteria, you specify your filter. Like for example, here I want to filter the department names which begin with the letter A. So, we will be discussing about these commands and these functions later on, but this is just an introduction. So, when I am trying to compare text, I will use the operator like for comparison of text, and I am writing A star. Now, star here means that the first letter has to be A. After A, you can have any letter, any character, any number of times. So, we say that this is a wildcard character. So, some versions of SQL will support percent sign also, but in Microsoft Access we basically use the star sign. So, once you run the query, what you see is the result. So, the result of the query is also a table, as you can see. So, you are able to see the department code and you are also able to see the department names, because these two things I had used, and I had used the filter on the department name. So, now what you are seeing is only the names of departments which begin with the letter A. So, similarly, you can run simple queries, and by giving the correct comparison statement or the expression in the criteria, you can filter the records based on the given criteria that you need the records for. Now, when you want to manipulate these queries, for example, when you want to sort in one, you can use the criteria, you can add more than one field from the table. We have just seen that how two fields can be added, and more than one table can be added to combine the data among the two tables. So, basically, when you are trying to edit the data in a query, a simple select query will just display the data, and the data remains in the table which is unchanged. So, it is only going to filter, or it is only going to retrieve the record and show it to you, right? But the query, the data will not change. But in this case, if you see, if you can open the data sheet view of the query, then you can see the data is shown, and here you can manipulate the data. So, once you manipulate the data, that change will be written to the table. So, one has to be very careful when you are working with the data sheet view of the query, that your data, the changes written into the table should be, there should not be any changes which you write in the data sheet view of the query, because those are then saved into your table and the data in your table will get modified, it will get changed, which should not happen. So, if you want to save, generally there is a decision about whether you want to save the query or you do not want to save it. So, generally people make quick ad hoc queries and they do not save it, right? But if you know that the same query is going to be used over and over again, so the best idea is to save your query, and whatever changes you are making, then you can go on changing to the same query. So, generally queries are saved in databases because they can be used for any kind of future reference. So, saving changes or not saving changes is up to the database designer, but it is generally advisable to save all the changes that you have made to the query design. Then we also know that there are, you know, there are some magic words, there are some comparisons, there are some pattern matching, there is some comparison of numbers which you can do when you are trying to retrieve or you are trying to pull out data from your query. So, there is a large number of expressions which are available in different versions of SQL which you can use. So, for example, for numeric fields, if you are using numbers, for example, if you are comparing any two quantities like salary or you are calling any two quantitative numbers, then you can use the symbols, simple symbols like less than, greater than, equal to, not equal to, right? So, all these can be used. If you are working with dates, even then these symbols will work. If you want to find out the date which is falling before or which is falling after or within a specific range, then also the numeric comparison operators, the logical comparison operators will work. If you are using greater than 0, so then if you use greater than 0, that is used to drop blank values. If there is any blank value means it is minus 1. So, any value more than greater than 0 will mean that the blank values will be dropped from there. Then it is important to know in case of text fields, if you are using is not null will omit any blank values. I already explained what is the significance of the word null or the null value, and is null will show the blank values. Even if you show an empty quotation mark, which will also mean that the value is null. The empty quotation marks means that the value is not null because there is a space in between. So, these changes the view, not the record. So, whatever changes you are making, these are only being made in the view of the table, but actual query remains the same. This is basically trying to filter or trying to retrieve the records from the table, and it is not going to affect the data in the table unless you make the changes in the data sheet view of the table. Then also we can add code fields to the table. If it does not have the code fields, you can use queries for that as well. You can make a query with the text field and the code field next to each other, and then you can sort the text field alphabetically. So, this will help you assign codes to your text fields. So, queries become a very important tool in this perspective also, because it allows you to sort your text fields depending upon the code that you have assigned to your data while you are running that particular query. So, these also help us to group the records with the same text. So, they identify groups to assign codes, then you write the code number in those records, and you check for variations and misspellings and then fix them. So, you add the new codes to the lookup table and you define them. So, lookup tables are very important feature in Access because they help us in giving the user with a predefined, predetermined list of items, and these items, from these items the requisite item can easily be chosen. So, designing lookups is a separate part which we will be dealing later, but lookup tables help us in assigning these new codes, adding the codes and defining them. So, this will help us in organizing the data and checking the validation of the data there. So, the Access also allows the queries to fetch data from two tables. So, we have seen that there are two table queries also. So, in this case when you have a linking field, when you have a common field between the two tables, then you can create the link which is known as a join. So, join basically means that you are trying to combine the data from the two tables. So, what data will be displayed will depend upon the nature of the relation between the tables, that is whether it is a one to one, it is a one to many, or and also the type of join. So, we will be talking about the different types of joins which are possible while you are creating the association between the tables. So, there are different types of joins which combine data in different formats. So, this is all for today's lecture. We will be talking about validation, lookups and joins in the next part of the lecture. Till then, thank you.